could set up a camera to record that, so I don't know. That's kind of a dream. But anyways, let's get into talking about Carnap. So, starting with some biographical information, Rudolf Carnap was another logical positivist, just like civic duty, because he was a pacifist. He studied with Frege, and went to his lectures on mathematical logic, and he was in touch with Bertrand Russell, and good friends with Quine, who I'll talk about later. He was acquainted with Wittgenstein, because Wittgenstein visited the Vienna Circle, which was where logical positivism came from. And he was one of the core members of that Vienna Circle. And he moved to the U.S. in 1935 because he was a pacifist and a socialist, and those are not things that you want to be in Nazi Germany. And around that time was when a lot of the Vienna Circle out of that area to get away from the Nazis, and that's when, on a historical note, like, the core of analytic philosophy moved to the U.S. and Britain, because all of the people from Germany and stuff moved to those areas to get away from the Nazis. So today, we're going to be talking about his paper, Empiricism, Semantics, and Ontology. And in the paper, he sets out to create a system of semantics that solves many of the problems that other logical positivists ran into when trying to get rid of the metaphysical pseudo-questions, as they said, where they would either accidentally allow in too much metaphysics or accidentally rule out science, and this one solves a problem on the other side of accidentally ruling out science and other non-metaphysical garbage stuff that they would want to keep. So, let's get into it. So, the way that Carnap approached this problem was by Hitler said about tautologies, and that he said that using such a language, meaning an abstract language like mathematics, is perfectly compatible with empiricism and strictly scientific thinking. So, Carnap introduces the idea of linguistic frameworks like this, and he says, if someone wishes to speak in his language about a new kind of entities, he has to introduce a system of new ways of speaking, subject to new rules. We should call this procedure the construction of a framework for the new entities in question. So, for example, if I wanted to speak about numbers and math, I could introduce a framework of rules that lay out the rules for mathematics. And then inside of that framework, we could talk about math. So the framework might have like rules for like addition, where you add the two numbers together, or at a more basic level would say like 5 represents a number. 5 is a number. There is a class of things that is numbers. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. are parts of that class. And then it would lay out rules for adding and subtracting, etc. So, importantly, this way of thinking about language in terms of separated frameworks of meaning lends itself to a divide between two types of questions. What Carnap calls internal questions and external questions. So, internal questions are internal to the framework that they're talking about and can clearly be answered by the rules that the framework sets out, and which the question is internal to. So for example, like, is 5 a number? We could answer that by saying, yes, the number framework says that 5 is a number. If we're answering it internally. And then there's another type of question called external questions. And they ask questions external to the framework. And this makes them problematic because they're asking questions about something where there aren't clear rules set out for how to answer them, like when you're asking an internal question. When I ask an internal question like, what's 5 plus 2? There are clear rules that I can use, the rules of addition, etc. And then using those rules, we can get to the answer of 7. But if I ask an external question that isn't inside of the framework, then there's not clear rules. So for example, if I asked, are numbers real in the external sense, Carnap would say that there's not a clear set of rules that I could use to answer that because it's not inside of a framework and it's trying to ask something about the real world, which to him we can't know anything about. So let's explore some examples that are similar to the ones that Carnap gives around this. So here are some internal questions to the framework of objects in space and time, or the framework of the outside world, or thing language, as he calls it. So, these types of questions would be like, do unicorns exist? Is there a cup of tea downstairs? Did Socrates exist? And for all of these questions, assuming that we've adopted the framework of language, we have clear rules for how to answer. So we could theoretically look at everything and see if it's a unicorn, and look at everything and say, are any of these things a unicorn? And then say no. Or I guess in a less certain way we could say, well, I've never seen a unicorn and I don't know anybody who's ever seen a unicorn. So, they don't exist. question. And, or maybe your version of thing language includes time travel, etc. And, but the important thing is that, given the acceptance of a framework to talk about thing language, all of these internal questions have a clear way on how they could be answered, as long as we agree on the framework. In contrast, here are some external questions. Does this system of space and time actually represent reality? And what actually exists? So unlike the previous questions, which were internal, Carnap sees these as being troublesome because they don't have the possibility for an explicitly defined way that we can answer them. As he says, to the question of whether the world actually exists, realists give an affirmative answer, idealists a negative one, and the controversy goes on for centuries without ever being solved. So realists and idealists are two classes of philosophers that have traditionally had a debate about whether the world is just in our mind or whether it actually exists, and Carnap thinks that they could never come to a definite answer because they're trying to ask an external question which doesn't have set rules for how to answer it. So, now that you see the difference between internal and external questions, you may be wondering how exactly Carnap avoids them. Because when you think that when someone starts using the thing language framework, they adopt a belief that things actually exist, and that what they're talking about actually exists, Carnap doesn't think so. As he says, I'm quoting him, there is no such assertion or assumption, i.e. the assertion that something exists, because it is not a theoretical question. To accept the thing world means nothing more than to accept a certain form of language. After all, I'm not quoting anymore, after all, when you adopt the thing world language framework, quoting again, the thesis of the reality of the thing world cannot be among the statements that you are asserting, because it cannot be formulated in the thing language. So basically what he's saying is that when you adopt the thing language framework, you're not adopting a belief that you're talking about some actual reality, because you can't ask questions about actual reality inside of the thing language framework. You can't ask an external question from inside of the framework internally. So then, another question you might have would be, if Carnap thinks that we aren't able to decide whether or not to accept a linguistic framework based on whether it's right or not in like a capital T truth way, then how are we supposed to decide what frameworks we adopt? It seems kind of arbitrary. To that, Carnap would say that, quoting again, those who raise the question of the reality of the thing world itself have perhaps in mind not a theoretical question, as their formulation seems to suggest, but rather a practical question, a matter of practical decision concerning the structure of our language. We have to make the choice whether or not to accept and use the forms of expression for the framework in question. So what he means by this is that the decision is pragmatic, and he makes this clear later when he says, quoting again, the decision of accepting the thing language will be influenced by the theoretical knowledge, just like any other deliberate decision concerning the acceptance of linguistic or other rules. The purposes for which language is intended to be used will determine which factors are relevant for the decision. The efficiency, fruitfulness, and simplicity of the language will be among the decisive factors. But these questions cannot be identified with the question of realism. They are not yes just think language, but any linguistic framework based on how useful it is to us, basically, instead of any attempt to try and show how it's real or not. So basically he's saying that saying anything about the capital D truth is kind of impossible because it's an external question. So we should just adopt frameworks based on how much they help us navigate the world, not if they're true or not. So, now that we understand what's involved in a framework, let's go a little bit deeper into what Carnap thinks we should think about when we want to adopt a framework. So, in section 3 of the paper, which is about the topic, Carnap says that the two essential steps in introducing and accepting a new framework are the following. First, the introduction of a general term, a predicate of higher level for the new kind of entities, permitting us to say in any of any particular thing that it belongs to this kind, e.g., red is a property, five is a number. Second, the introduction of variables of the new type. The new entities are valuables of these variables, the constants, and the closed compound expressions, if any, are substitutable for the variables. With the help of the variables, general sentences concerning the new entities can be formulated. So, I know that's a little bit dense, but what he's saying there is that what we need to do in order to introduce a new framework is to introduce a name for the entities in that framework. So, like, if we're introducing the framework of math, then we would be introducing numbers. So that would be the name. And then a system of variables that can set out the rules for the new entities involved in the framework. So, like, yeah, just variables. So, like, x, if we're talking about algebra and math again. So, but one thing, importantly, is not included in the adoption of the framework, and that is any assertion of capital D truth. Because, as he said earlier, it needs to be decided on pragmatic terms whether or not we adopt it. So, as he says in this portion, the introduction of new ways of speaking does not need any theoretical justification because it does not apply any assertion of reality. We may still speak, and have done so, of the acceptance of the framework or the acceptance of new entities, but one must keep in mind that these phrases do not mean for us anything more than acceptance of the new linguistic forms. Above all, they must not be interpreted as referring to an assumption, belief, or assertion of the reality of the entities. There is no such assertion. Alleged statement of the reality of the framework of entities is a pseudo-statement without cognitive content. So, he says it really clearly here, I think, especially when he says that the introduction of the new ways of speaking does not need any theoretical justification because it does not imply any assertion of reality. So basically he's saying that we never should ever or do ever make any claims about capital D truth when we're adopting a new linguistic framework, because, well, he doesn't really give a because, but he just says that it's just not something that we do. And I guess when he says we, he's talking from, like, the logical positivist, or he calls himself a logical empiricist, I believe. But they're pretty much interchangeable. So it really kind of helps to drive home the implications of what he's pointing out here, or presenting, which is basically that there are no truths that are available to us, and anybody who tries to talk about them is just was for abstract entities like numbers and colors. So many other logical positivists of the time would claim that statements like purple is a property of things, five is a number, or color designates a property of properties of things are not actually designating sentences because there is no real object that they could designate to, seeing as none of them would want to claim in a platonic or transcendent way that entities like numbers actually exist, or that there is some one real thing purple that we refer to every time we call something purple, or that color as a concept is some object that we designate to whenever we talk about color. So Carnap's system is useful in solving these problems, because although he kind of moves the goalpost a little bit away from the question about true reality, because he doesn't think we can really talk about that in any meaningful way, through the adoption of a linguistic framework, we then get things that we can designate when we're talking about these things. So assuming that both you and I have adopted the linguistic framework of colors, then if I talk about purple, then we both have something that I'm referring to, which is the object of purple inside of our linguistic framework that we share. And the same goes for five with the linguistic framework of numbers, and color with the linguistic framework of properties of things. So that solves that problem, and that's the main reason that Carnap set out to do this, because previously a lot of logical positivists were running into problems with seeing how mathematics and specifically physics could be meaningful. Carnap was somewhat of a physicist himself. He read Einstein, and I think he might have even studied under Einstein. I'm not 100% sure about that, so don't quote me on it. I know he at least went to a university where Einstein was a professor, and that he wanted to study physics for a while. He even submitted a thesis, I read that he submitted a thesis to the physics department, and the physics department was like, this is too philosophical. And then he submitted it to the philosophy department, and they were like, this is a physics paper. So then he reworked it with a philosophy professor, and ended up publishing it as a philosophy paper, but it's just kind of funny. But yeah, he studied physics, or at least was very interested in it, and he wrote some stuff on physics too during his life. So, wow, that was a big tangent. I don't know really where I left off, but I think we was just about to move on to criticisms of the theory, or things that kind of irk me about it, now that we kind of understand the theory. So one thing that Carnap repeatedly does in the paper, which is typical of logical positivist writing, is to dismiss metaphysical pseudo-questions as meaningless, or, in Carnap's words, without cognitive content. So, that said, although Carnap does point out that many of these metaphysical debates have been going on for quite a long time, and that sometimes it seems like, to quote him, sometimes it seems like there is not, to quote him, any possible evidence that would be regarded as relevant by both sides of the debate. For example, the realist-idealist thing he was talking about earlier. sides of the debate, and therefore, if actually found, would decide the controversy. So basically, he thinks that these metaphysical disputes don't have any criteria for how you would decide whether or not they're right, because they're asking external questions. So my criticisms to that is that, for one, I think it's debatable whether or not there is actually no evidence that could be presented to either side of the debate, although I could definitely see it. I'm not like an expert on these debates. I'm still very new to philosophy generally, and I definitely don't know enough about the realist idealist debate to really comment on it from any privileged viewpoint, but on a deeper level, even if there was no evidence that would be relevant, wouldn't that just show that they're using different linguistic frameworks of metaphysics or things in themselves, with different sets of rules for how to answer the question? Because, I mean, I'm assuming that both the idealists and the realists think that they are right, and they think that they have reasons that they are right, so they must think that there are rules for how you can decide who's right in a debate like this. And I know that that is kind of treasonous in this system of linguistic frameworks, because it is talking about capital T truth, but I don't see any reason why you couldn't have a linguistic framework to talk about metaphysical debates. It just seems like Carnap kind of arbitrarily decides to rule out metaphysics as a possible linguistic framework, without ever actually justifying why he does that. I suppose that he could say that there's no pragmatic value in talking about that stuff, but it's, well, I would argue that A, there is, because there could be implications on the real world, and also it's just enjoyable for some people to talk about and think about regardless. So yeah, I don't really see why there couldn't be a metaphysics linguistic framework that people could talk about and that would solve the problem if they both, the problem between the realists and the idealists and really any metaphysical debate, if they both adopted the same framework to talk about it. And then another thing, so that's one problem, which is I don't see how this rules out metaphysics from being a thing that you could talk about. It seems like you could just have a metaphysical framework. And the second thing that irks me about this paper is how it just kind of assumes that the pragmatic linguistic framework is prior to all other frameworks and assumes that we've adopted it because, as he says in the paper, you can't adopt a framework based on its reality or truth because those are external questions. But you would rather address it based on its pragmatic value. Or like its simplicity of use and how useful it is to us, which is basically pragmatic value. But nowhere does he say why we should care about pragmatic value or why we should adopt the pragmatic value framework in analyzing whether or not we should adopt other frameworks. Which means that the only reason he offers for why we should adopt frameworks is pragmatics. The only reason we would have to adopt pragmatics is pragmatics, which is pretty obviously a circular definition, which is a big no-no, logically. And I'm sure Carnap would respond by saying that there's no better way that we could answer the question, because we can't actually make statements about truth because we have use of pragmatics as like the base thing, because it, I think that that's just something he doesn't talk about at all in the paper. And also, one final criticism.